morning.
Good morning.
And welcome on this second Sunday of Advent. And I would also like to welcome those of you who are following us on our YouTube. We're glad that you braved the cold and the hour early to be here. Thank you. I invite you to take a moment now to turn and greet those around you.
Thank you.
Gracious God, it is fitting to mourn the tragedy in Ukraine and the senseless deaths of civilians whose lives have become a daily struggle for survival. It is fitting to grieve the loss of a dear friend whose familiar face shall be missed. It is fitting to hold close in our hearts family and friends who are struggling, and we pray for those whose lives are difficult, and they may find blessings in each day. We pray for the families of those who have died, that they may feel the comfort of your loving presence. But it is also fitting to celebrate the birth of a baby and the joy that baby brings to his parents and his grandparents. It is fitting to be nourished by the beauty of the late season snowfall and to put aside daily tasks to be enchanted by nature. Life is not pure joy. It will always be visited by tragedy. But help us, even in our despair, to grab the opportunities to rejoice. Amen. Will you join me now for the responsive reading? This is the mission of our faith.
To teach the fragile heart of hospitality.
To revere both the critical mind and the generous heart.
To prove that diversity need not mean divisiveness.
And to witness to all.
And that we must hold the whole world in our hands.
Thank you.
coming?
You were doing it very quickly there.
Okay, I gotta turn the microphone on so that you can hear. Okay. Well, most of you are on spring break, right? So you can sweep a little bit this way to get used to this new change. All right. I want to talk about two words today. You need to close that. Thank you. And I want you to figure out what those words are, but I'm going to show you the picture. It's the first one. Second one, very easy. It's the first one. Okay. Let me show you on the cloud. Okay. You have to put these things together to make a word. Figure out what it is. I know what that is. Okay, let's start here. You see three people. What can you tell me about this person compared to these people? Has more hair. What else did you say? Hold the microphone. Okay, okay. Tall, not tallest, but tall. Tall. And then what's this? Tolerate. Very good. The word.
Isn't that clever? I made that up.
Tolerate. Okay, that's our first word. Y'all heard that word, right? Tolerate. Okay, here's the next one. This one's easy. Love. Yes, very good. Okay. It is a heart. But a heart often stands for love. Okay. Give you a couple of examples, and we can talk a little bit about what these words mean. Okay, tolerate and love. Okay, let's suppose you ask me if I like pumpkin pie. And I'm going to tell you I can tolerate pumpkin pie. How do you think I feel about pumpkin pie? It's not my favorite. But it is okay. You're not a fan either, okay? Remember that, Mom. Okay. Now let's suppose you ask me if I like chocolate pie. I'm going to tell you I love chocolate pie. So, how do I feel about chocolate pie? It's amazing. That's a good word. Chocolate pie is very amazing. Okay. So if I have a choice between pumpkin pie and chocolate pie, which one am I going to choose every time? You can have my pee. You like pumpkin pie, you can have my pee. You're right, I'm going to choose chocolate pie. Now, if there's only pumpkin pie, I'll eat it. Okay. Now, when it comes to people, tolerating is important. Why? Why is it important to tolerate people? Behind you got something? Okay, so that they'll sort of like you. What else? Okay, you may grow fond of them. I like that. That's a good point. You can start by tolerating, and then maybe you might grow a little bit more. Okay, anybody else? I think important that we tolerate each other. What if your brother or your sister has a habit that just really gets on your nerves? And you don't tolerate that habit, what might you do? Yeah, you might just beat them up, right? Sarah, you'd be that same, wouldn't you? Yeah. So if you tolerate them, then what do you not do? Right, you don't beat them up. Okay, so tolerance is important. It helps us get along when otherwise we might have a little trouble getting along. But let me ask you this. How does it really feel to be tolerated and not loved? Okay, you may feel like, okay, they're letting me sit with them, but they don't really like me all that much. Okay, anybody else? something they want to add to that. You might feel left out, even if you're in the group, you might feel a little bit left out. Okay, very good. Anybody else? Y'all are hitting the nail on the head. Very good. Okay. Sometimes we have to go a little bit out of our way to let people know that we really care about them, that we're not just hollering them. And you all do that every Sunday morning when you sit up here with me. Did you know that? Maybe not. Let me tell you. You know I'm hard of hearing, right? I mean, it's obvious, yeah. And there have been times when I have been in a group and they're fine with my being there. They know I'm hard of hearing, but they don't do anything to make sure I can follow the conversation. So I'm being tolerated, but I don't really feel like I'm part of the group. Okay? But what are some of the things that you all do to make me feel like I'm part of the group? Come here. You use the microphone. Excellent. You're not embarrassed to pass it around and talk into it. Very good. What else? You don't even know how to do this thing. You talk to me, but how? Yes, yeah, you talk a little more loudly. What else? Very good. You tell me what somebody else is saying. They have a quiet voice. You can tell me. Something else you do. Do you look that way when you're talking to me? Yes, you look right at me, and I've noticed that your parents have helped you learn how to do that. So you're looking right at me. And you're not afraid to repeat things. Ma'am, I'm going to tell a story that you last week after church, I asked Liam a question. I did not have my microphone. The poor child had to say it at least 6 times. But he did not get upset. He did not get impatient. He just kept saying what he was saying, and so I understood. Thank you so much. So you all do these things, and it makes me feel loved and part of the group. So thank you very much. And thank you for being here today on this cold day. You all have fun at Sunday school. Will you join me now for hymn 292?
Thank you.
comrade. As Abraham was sitting at the entrance of his tent during the hottest part of the day, he looked up and saw three men standing there. As soon as he saw them, he ran up to meet them. Bowing down, his face touching the ground, he said, "Sirs, please do not pass by my home without stopping. I am here to serve you. Let me bring some water for you to wash your feet. You can rest here beneath this tree. I will also bring a bit of food. It will give you strength to continue your journey. You have honored me by coming to my home, so let me serve you." They replied, "Thank you. We accept." Abraham hurried into the tent and said to Sarah, "Quick, take a sack of your best flour and make some bread." Then he ran to the herd and picked out a calf that was tender and fat and gave it to a servant who hurried to get it ready. He took some cream, some milk, and the meat and set the food before the men. There under the tree, he served them and they ate. And our contemporary reading is from Sheila Cassidy. If I and a doctor spend an hour of my clinic time talking to a woman who has only a few weeks to live, I am making a clear statement of her worth. I am giving her time that could have been spent with people who will get better, who will be able to contribute once again to the common good. I am affirming the worth of one individual person in a world in which the individual is at risk of being submerged or valued only for his strength, intellect, or beauty. It is a prophetic statement about the unique value of the human person, irrespective of age, social class, or productivity. It is an affirmation that people matter just because they are people, because God made them and loved them just as they are, not because they are good or witty or physically beautiful. Will you join me now for prayer and time of reflection? Loving God, it is easy to be overwhelmed by the great need of so many people in our community and larger world. We read about Abraham and feel that nothing we can do would ever measure up to the loving kindness he showed the strangers in his midst. But we should remember the times when small acts of kindness were shown to us, when someone held a door open or brought us a meal, mowed our lawn, or sent a card to cheer us up. Sometimes all we have to give is our time, but this can be the greatest gift of all. Help us to not shy away from the small acts of kindness because we feel they won't be enough. Help us to remember that acts done in love are never wasted. The Lenten season gives us the opportunity to turn inward and reflect both independently and together on our individual lives and on our life in community. We are very much aware of what is happening outside these doors. The war in Ukraine is devastating. Just this week, a children's hospital and kindergarten were bombed, and a humanitarian crisis is unfolding as we watch. These atrocities not only make us feel helpless, but they also force us to acknowledge that we are swimming in murky moral waters. Since childhood, I have heard the phrase, "never again," in reference to the Holocaust. and the saying that those who don't know history are doomed to repeat it. And yet here we are, very much aware of the similarity between actions and decisions made today and the mistakes of our past, and trying desperately to figure out the lesser of two evils. I feel like my own moral contribution had been reduced to keeping up with current events and railing at the injustice and inhumanity of it all. In our own nation, voter rights continue to be assaulted. The hard-earned rights of the LGBTQ community are on the chopping block, and calls to ban books are sweeping the nation. And at this point, is anyone even listening to the dire warnings about the climate and fate of our planet? In the midst of these storms that brew around us, we come to this chapel on the hill on Sunday morning. We all need a moment of calm. We need to reconnect with the people who care about us and to feel the warm embrace of community. But we may also feel an incongruence, that there's a disconnect between church and what's happening in the world. So during this Lenten season, we can ask ourselves how we as a church should be responding to the many transgressions against creation. There is no one-size-fits-all answer to that question. Every congregation is unique, and every congregation has to figure out how to follow the path that Jesus has set before us. Last week I talked about the table that Jesus built. If you weren't here, the table is a metaphor for the welcoming community that Jesus tried to initiate, a microcosm of the kingdom of God. John Pavlovich, in his book, A Bigger Table, writes of the four legs that support that table. Today we will look at the first leg of radical hospitality. It's not a complicated notion. In fact, when I told my daughter Sienna what my sermon topic was for today, she asked jokingly, so radical hospitality means actually adopting someone into your family, which isn't far off the mark. Now here's what I'm asking you to think about, if you can. And I know that you have very full lives, and this can be something that you ponder while you're washing the dishes or you're walking the dog. Let's start with the proposition that the heart of Jesus' ministry is the bigger table. And let's say that we are ready to commit ourselves to pursuing that idea more fully. What would that look like for us? Not for First United Methodist, not for the Unitarians, not for St. Stephen's, but for us. Now let's get back to that first leg of the table. Hospitality was critical in the nomadic culture of the ancient world, where strangers depended on the kindness of residents as they passed through the land. Biblical hospitality took many forms, offering the necessity of food, lodging, and protection, allowing people to harvest from the edges of your land, providing clothes for the naked and hiding food for the poor, as well as welcoming strangers in religious celebrations. In today's story, Abraham practiced hospitality with three strangers, while we know that God is one of those, Abraham does not. Abraham's hospitality involved a lot of verbs. First, he sees the strangers, then he runs to meet them. He invites them, refreshes them, prepares a feast for them, and honors them. I was struck by the similarity between Abraham's actions and the father's actions and that final scene in the parable of the prodigal son. This parable is one of Jesus' most famous illustrations of the nature of the kingdom of God. And the key to this final scene is the hospitality that the father extends to the son, who no longer has any claim to the family. The father saw his son, ran to meet him, lavished him with new clothes, prepared the fatted calf, and honored him with a feast and a celebration. If this is the kingdom of God, then hospitality is more than just mere survival. It is also the essence of God. Consider the central story of Judaism, the exodus of the Israelites from slavery in Egypt. God took a people who were not just strangers in a foreign land, but slaves. They had no status and no way to live outside of bondage. God adopted them, to use Sin's phrase, and made them God's own. This is the defining act of God and God's relationship to the Jewish people. And it is an understanding of the character of the divine that we don't really see anywhere else in the ancient world. So hospitality is not just about the golden rule. It's about mimicking God. And it's built on the shared, remembered narrative of the Jewish people. Throughout the Torah, the Jewish people were admonished to remember that they once were strangers in a foreign land. They were commanded to care for the poor, the widow, the orphans, and the stranger residing in their land. According to Rabbi Barry Fell Schwartz, this idea of a stranger in a foreign land is not incidental, but central to the Torah. And remembering is crucial. And how we remember and respond to our collective past influences who we are as a moral community. According to the narrative, the Jewish people suffered tremendous injustice at the hands of the Egyptians. Such a memory could easily lead to a morality of vengeance, an eye for an eye and a tooth for a tooth. And I suspect many examples of just that kind of response exist in history. By exhorting the Jewish people to not forget that they were once strangers in a foreign land, the Torah helped shape a people for whom hospitality was the backbone of their moral code. But beyond killing the fatted calf, offering clothing and protection, what exactly is hospitality? Well, it's the offer to extend the privileges of community to those who do not have the standing to expect it, especially those who are vulnerable because they are strangers. Perhaps this is easier when the stranger happens to be God. But unfortunately, for many people who are outside of a community, hospitality is too often replaced by tolerance and ambivalence. which is not to say that tolerance doesn't have a place. In a nation and a world where intolerance often leads to brutality, tolerance is critical. But no one is going to stay long at a table where they are met with ambivalence and simply tolerated. This is not what people need when they walk into a church. They need the welcome that Abraham gave his guest and that the Father gave his prodigal son. Now, I'm not suggesting that we throw our arms around everyone who walked through those doors, but we need the attitude that's behind it. What Pavlovitz calls lavish acceptance. Lavish acceptance allows us to rest comfortably as ourselves. As Pavlovitz said, when we no longer feel compelled to prove our worth, we can simply fall into our belovedness and exhale. This type of radical hospitality may necessitate changing the church's focus. Most churches are interested in who's coming in the front doors, and we all hope to see visitors on Sunday morning. But we need to be just as aware of who is exiting through the back doors and why. No church is a perfect fit for everyone. But if people enter a church and feel the coolness of ambivalence rather than the warmth of hospitality, it's not likely that they will come back, even if that church might suit them perfectly. Now let me pause here and remind you that you are a wonderfully warm congregation. You engage each other and visitors alike, and I am very appreciative of that. It is good to look around occasionally and see who's missing, and to ask ourselves whom we are excluding, even accidentally, and how we might be putting up barriers for some people. These are not easy questions. And Pavlovitz cautions that expanding the table can be a momentum killer and an agenda changer. When we'd like to put our focus on the fun stuff, like polishing worship surfaces, preparing delicious food for fellowship meals, we may be asked to slow down and listen to the stories and tend to the needs of the people who may not have found a place at our table before. And making room for new people can also feel threatening as we wonder what bigger changes might lie ahead. Following the way of Jesus is not easy. But as we gather together and enjoy the warm embrace of community on this cold winter morning, let us remember that we too were once strangers in a foreign land. And let us commit ourselves to practicing the divine act of hospitality. Thank you. Amen. Will you join me now for hymn 388?
Thank you.
Let us consider what it means for us to follow Jesus' example of inviting people to join us at the table.